Well, I'm still alive, but I had to take emergency measures today to stay that way. I had to actually push myself out onto a golf course, which gives me like 4 hours of complete forgetfulness of the world and all problems. It's just, you just go into a zone, a twilight zone for a while. I needed that, but I'm exhausted, very depressed today, and it's a real, real tough time. But, you know, sometimes I get mad at the Holy Spirit. A lot of times I do, because I don't feel the Holy Spirit's, you know, answering prayer. It never seems to answer prayer. Well, it answers prayer in a way that we don't understand, that we don't expect. And its answers are better than we expect. It answers in very creative ways. They say God works in very mysterious ways. Well, that's the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit worked in very mysterious ways today out on the golf course, I am telling you. It was suggested to me a little while back that I should stop trying to play the part of a golfer out on the course, and just let's play the part of just a very humble person who really is not acting like they know what they're doing so much. Just play the fool on the course. Don't raise expectations. Lower expectations. So it worked. So today I said, you know what? Let me just dress that way. Let me just look like I'm just walked in off the street, and I don't really know what I'm doing. I don't wear a hat. I don't have a golfer's belt. I got these new shoes. They're like rubber shoes, like Crocs with holes in them. And you never seen anybody wear those shoes on a golf course. Just wear ordinary pants and a big black sweatshirt, you know, over, and just. Just look like I really, maybe it's my first time out on the golf course. Don't clean the clubs or anything. Just lower expectations. So, going around, and there's these two rich kids in front of me, and they're really haughty, and you can tell they're real rich, haughty teenagers, I get up to them, and we run into a log jam on the course. And there's a foursome ahead of us, the Japanese tourists. Now, Japanese tourists, very good people, but they play very slow golf. Because over in Japan, golf is an all-day thing because it's so doggone expensive. They play 9 holes, then they stop and have lunch, they have a massage, they have some drinks, and then they play another 9 holes. It's an all-day thing. And they don't play ready golf. Each turn, everyone's very polite. They wait for everyone, and they just grind out. And every single thing is slow and meticulous. And there was like two foursomes ahead of these two guys, teenagers, and then me. And I realized I'm going to get absolutely nowhere today. It's a traffic jam. And first of all, I was waiting, and I just decided I'm going to go up ahead on the course and see what's going on. So I just went right in front of the teenagers and just went up ahead on the course as they're waiting. And I found out, there's a log jam. And so I came back, just came back. I didn't wait for their permission or anything. I just did it. And they had the typical entitlement, rich guy, entitlement type attitude, and I didn't pay any attention to it. I just went ahead and said, I'm going to do what I know is right and not worry about it. And then at that point, on the next hole, I just took off past them and decided I'm going to jump ahead to the 11th hole. I'm going to find out where there's no traffic on the course, where it's open, and I'm just going to start playing where it's open. Forget about it. So I skipped hole number 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Just skipped them entirely. Went to 11, and there was nobody in front of me at all. Nobody in front of me at all. So I said, okay, I got it made. So I got all the time in the world. I said, all right. So let me work on my driver, and I'm kind of trying different things. I said, does this work? Does that work? Does that work? And, you know, just trying to see if I can dial it in. And taking these awkward swigs because I'm trying different stuff. And so here comes a cart, a guy driving up in a cart, you know, a single guy, a single player. And I'm taking all these weird swings. And he kind of drives up to me, big smile on his face. He's looking at me. He's kind of like this Hawaiian type of guy. And he says, hi. I said, hey, you want to play through? And he goes, wow, yeah, well, how you doing out here is just kind of practicing, huh, out here. And then he says to me, Hey, have you ever taken a golf lesson? He says, in other words, he's saying, you really look like you need a golf lesson. he's really feeling sorry for me. He says, and I say, no, I played along. I said, no, I've never taken a lesson, which is true. And then he says, well, you know, it's okay. It's this golf game is a real tough game, you know. And he's being super kind and supportive because he thinks I'm out there on the golf course probably for my first time. Like, I just walked off the street. I have no idea what I'm doing. And so I just played along. I said, okay. So he drove up to the next hole. So once he's out of the way, I say, okay. And I'm working on something, still working on it. I found something. I took a mulligan on this hole because I've been working, trying to find something that really works well. And so then I just uncorked this incredible drive, over 300 yards, just absolutely crushed it. And I went looking for my ball, where is it? And I couldn't find it. And I looked up way, way up by the green on a par 4, 385. It's up there way by the, close to the green. I said, are you kidding me? That's by far and away the farthest I've ever hit it on that hole, by like 20 yards or more. So I just had to flip the sandwich up there right over the pin. And just missed the putt and this beautiful hole. And then I went to the next hole and just crushed another drive. Next hole, crushed another drive. Next hole, crushed another one. Next hole, crushed it. Next hole, crushed it. I was just crushing drives far as I ever hit it before. It's amazing. It's like just a complete miracle-like. I say, thank you, that guy, that Hawaiian that came up to me, said, good luck charm. He says, have you ever taken a lesson? And I guess God gave me a lesson right there and then and there. Showed me the game, showed me how it goes. I played just like lights out. So, very weird stuff's happening there. What's the moral of the story? The moral of the story is that the Holy Spirit's showing something and saying, you're going to run into a logjam in the world, okay? Well, you can get, everything's backed up, nothing's moving. It's a lot, you're stuck. You're stuck, and you're just not going to make it around the course. You're not going to make it before night falls. And instead of just being like feeling like you're helpless, or you can't do it because the rich kids are there and you don't want to affront them or whatever, you don't want to, you know, just act like you own the place or you can do what you want to do or just bother anybody. Instead of that, just say, hey, this is I don't want to be stuck. Let me sidestep the logjam. Sidestep the logjam. So I just sidestep the logjam because I know that course extremely well, so I know how to do it. I know how to sidestep it. Situations like that, I just say, hey, I'm not gonna just sit here for the next 2.5 hours just waiting and slowly, slowly, slowly waiting, backups, two groups back up every tee and forget it. Sidestep the world. When the world gets into this logjam, which it is, you will come across this logjam very soon. Sidestep it. Go to where it's all open and all free, and there's no problems there, no difficulty. And you can then, what'll happen? You'll find your game. So what happened to me? I played the fool. Like, I don't know what I'm doing, but that's okay. I'm smiling. Okay, have a great day. And then suddenly, I found my game. Just like amazing, absolutely amazing. And nothing like it. It was just incredible. Just crushing the ball so far, it was just incredible. And so, sidestep the problems that are coming in the world, and you'll find your game. Find your game. Now, where are these problems coming from? Well, as I have said in other videos, previous videos, the truth is that it's something that people don't understand because people don't realize there are other planets. Where there's people dwelling on, humanoids dwelling on other planets all over, many, 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 just in, you know, this, the local area, as it were. And when you die, drop the body on one planet, you assess where you want to go. There's an assessment that takes place, and it's not just your personal assessment. There's a way that it happens that you decide, hey, let's go to this planet. And what has happened here is that there's a large, large, large number of people taking birth on this planet who are from another planet, previously were from another planet, or several planets in a confederacy. I call it the Reptilian Confederacy. They're from reptilian-based planets. And, you know, reptilians are different. I'm not demonizing them. They have different ways, okay? and they too can be enlightened, accept the bliss of the God's non-judgment upon all what ifs too. But the fact is that there was a huge exodus from the reptilian planets to planet Earth, and their plan is to take over planet Earth and turn it into a reptilian planet like the ones that they're used to. They may have had many incarnations on those reptilian planets, but they've come to planet Earth now. So it's like a massive invasion of planet Earth. It's like a massive illegal immigration type of thing, which is why they side with illegal immigration, because they say, hey, that's what they're doing, kind of. They're crashing. They're gate crashers. They're basically coming into a planet from other planets and telling the locals of this planet, people who have been in many lives on this planet, such as myself, they're basically telling us what to do, bullying us, bossing us around, bullying us, and deciding they're going to change the ways of this planet into the ways that they're familiar with. So that's why you have all this massive change taking place on the planet of stuff that to us, just the locals, just seem nuts. But, you know, this is something that happens on this planet too, when the imperialism, colonialism and imperialism, you go in like, for instance, like Hawaii, the native Hawaiians are there, and then they, you know, the people come in from other places and take the islands over, basically, is what happens, is what's happened. I mean, you have all sorts of immigration. You have, first you had the white, as the white Caucasians came into Hawaii, then the Japanese came into Hawaii, the Filipinos came into Hawaii, and all these different groups, and then the locals become the minorities, and they're, all the rules and everything has changed, and they don't, you know, lose a say-so kind of thing. That's what's happened with this world. That's what's happening. You wonder, where does all this technology come from? Why are the young people so adept at it? These people come in the world, they're just geniuses at all this super high tech. It's like a piece of cake for them, because they have had many lives on planets where this technology has been utilized for a long time. Reptilian planets are very heavy on technology and roboticism and gadgets, etc. So you have many incarnations on those type of planets. You come to this planet Earth, you say, hey, where are all my gadgets? Where's all my machine language? Where's all the internet? Where's the computer systems? Where's all this stuff? You know, I want it. And you just say, oh, I'll invent it, or I'll make it. It's easy. It's easy for them. Whereas like for me, I couldn't do a single line of code if my life depended on it. I couldn't build a gadget. I couldn't do anything like that, because I have absolutely no interest and no memory of that stuff at all. This is all completely foreign to me. I can simply use a computer by making a couple clicks and stuff like this, yeah. But that's about it. So, this planet has been invaded. Let's call it what it is, an invasion. And the locals of this planet are getting bullied, very severely bullied. And if they don't go along with the agenda, the cultural agenda of the invaders, they are called demonized. They're demonized. That's what's happened. The same thing as colonialism, you know, like the East India Company taking over India, basically. And then the Indians are demonized and made into a subservient position and told that they're inferior and that their ways are backwards and all this kind of stuff. And well, what happens? Famine after famine after famine after famine after famine, because the profit motive of the East India Company didn't allow, they were growing cash crops like opium for China, which they had invaded and got as many Chinese addicted to opium as possible, so that they could then sell all their opium from India to China. And they forced the people in India to grow these cash crops instead of food crops. And then when the monsoons failed, there was no reserves of any food crops at all, and complete shortage of food. And what happened? Millions and millions and millions of people starved to death. And they had these recurrent famines take place, and all the illnesses and stuff. And it was just a nightmare, really a nightmare. And they also would sell the grains for profit around the world. They'd say, well, let's sell over here in this market over here. So they left the Indians with no reserves. Because they say, well, making money is God's mandate to us. So it's okay if 10 million Indians starve to death. As long as we're making money, God is okay with it. You know, just insane stuff. There's examples throughout history of this. It's just that right now we're getting it on a global scale of people coming from other planets to this planet, basically taking it over. And they've, for all intents and purposes, they're in the process. They're succeeding. They will succeed at taking this planet over, and in doing so, cause unbelievable amount of stress to the locals here. Telling, you know, demonizing us and telling us how stupid we are and all this kind of stuff, and completely ignoring the wisdom that we have built up on this planet for so long, as if it's not even a subject worthy of mention. So, when they bring everything to a standstill so they can institute a dictatorship, which they want to institute, so it's like the reptilian worlds they're from, which is a very much of a top-down, heavy, authoritative, totalitarian, bureaucratic control system, which is what they're used to, which is what they want, and they want to social engineer everything, control everything, control freaks. They're going to bring up this logjam in the world where the world just freezes up and you can't go anywhere and you're stuck. So what do? You say, hey, go somewhere else. We'll go somewhere else. You're not going to bully us like that. And for those who realize there are many, many dwelling places, Jesus told us that. And his parting words were, don't be worried. Don't be worried. Don't be alarmed. Don't be worried. There are many dwelling places. Okay. And if this weren't so, I would have told you. Many dwelling places, and he says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And so, and then when I'll come back at the end of the age and take you there so you can dwell with me in that place. In other words, it must be a very, very nice, nice place, that is for sure. So simply, that is the faith that the natives of this planet, those who have been on this planet a long time, they have been told, look, your planet will be invaded, it will be taken over, but... and there'll be some really bad stuff take place, but you will have the opportunity to sidestep it all. Go to the 11th tee, right? Go to the 11th tee, sidestep it. You can do it, you can do it. Nobody told me I could, I just said, hey, I'm gonna do it. Nobody told me I couldn't either. You know, nobody's gonna say you can't do it. Say, well, I am gonna do it. I'm gonna go look for a place that's freedom. I mean, this planet, freedom is gone. Freedom is gone here. What you have is really a soft tyranny at this point. You don't have freedom anymore. It's a joke. So, Holy Spirit showed me in this golf game, it showed me a lot of things. And it showed me that when you get free of this planet, you are going to find your game like a miracle. I mean, just like, wow. It was a different stance. The ball's like in the middle. And everything I did was a little bit different, and it just crushed the ball. It was just amazing. The power suddenly returned, just returned like the heyday. You know, when I'm young, hitting the ball 300 yards. That's like that's major distance and power. And I'm tired. I'm weak. I'm tired, but I still hit it that far. It's incredible. So. You sidestep the situation and you'll find your game. That's the promise the Holy Spirit was telling me. Don't stay in this situation. There's nothing here. You're just going to get bogged down in a morass. You'll be turned into sepoys, you know, Uncle Toms. You will just be trying to get along like a good little slave, smiling and doing the fan and serving the stuff. Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, you know, that kind of thing. Bowing to the almighty righteous ones who are telling everybody else what to do and what's right and what's wrong, as if it were coming on high from God. I'll tell you what is right. What is right is salvation, and I'll tell you what is productive. What is productive is bliss. In fact, bliss is the only situation that's productive. Everything else is basically nothing. It's kind of like we're trying to build a home for nothing. We're trying to build a home for idols, but idols represent nothing. And so here we're desperately trying to build a home for nothing. Nothing at all. You know, that's really what we're trying to do with existence. But Bliss solves the continuity problem for us, so we can stop this ridiculous attempt to build a home for nothing and accept our home, the home for everything, which is reality, which is the kingdom of heaven. So, today I just realized, hey, I can sidestep situation. I can go to a different situation. We don't have to, we're not bound to stay in line here, okay? See, I was stuck on the fifth tee, and I said, wow, this is really terrible. And then we got to the sixth tee, I said, enough's enough, forget it. And I just didn't wait, and I just took off and drove past everybody, and goodbye, goodbye. I knew the back way. Went past the members only driving range. I knew how to go around. I knew how to sidestep. I knew how to, other people, they may not know that. They think they just have to keep, stay in line, like good little slaves, and just suffer, which is what it would have been, just suffering, waiting, suffering every, you know, wow, what a pain. You don't have to suffer. You don't have to stay in line. Take the back way, sidestep the situation. That's what the Holy Spirit has been pointing out to me over and over and over and over again. And I keep thinking, you know, that's a pipe dream. It's a pipe dream. Come on, give me something else. The Holy Spirit says, no. You'll find your game when you sidestep the situation. Because right now, you're so disempowered in this world. The world has gone so bad, you really cannot shine the way you're supposed to shine. Really cannot shine the way you're supposed to be shining. Now, the Holy Spirit keeps telling me it's like Hawaii. It's like playing golf in Hawaii. But I say, I don't want to go to Hawaii because there's a lot of turmoil in Hawaii, in this world. Because the locals there, they're fighting back. They very much resent what has happened. And they blame the white people, I think, mostly. If you're a white person in Hawaii, you are not in a good situation at all. It's dangerous, actually. You cannot, if you just stay in like Honolulu, the touristy places, then, you know, during daytime it's okay. But nighttime and evening, no. You can't go out walking on the beach, no way. You're going to get attacked, most likely, and beaten up. And if you go in the back country by yourself, if you're a white person going in the back country yourself, look out. We had somebody from this area. Oh, boy, I'm not going to even talk about it. It was so terrible. So it's not a place where you can be relaxed and feel free and safe. No way in the world. So the Holy Spirit is saying that the dwelling place that we can go to is like Hawaii, meaning it's a very beautiful place. Because Hawaii kind of represents the most beautiful place on this planet. In a lot of ways it is. I mean, the temperature is just incredible. The beauty, the freshness of the air, and it's just a gorgeous, wonderful place. I lived there for 2 years when I was very young, and I remember it still vividly. It's just a magic, wonderful place. Beautiful, beautiful place. Oh, boy. So what we're being told is that there's a place that is like Hawaii. It's like playing golf in Hawaii. In other words, relaxing. Relax. Find your game. We have a right to relax and find our game. We don't have to be part of the rat race. The Holy Spirit's not saying, hey, you're supposed to stay here on this planet and work things out, come to compromises, suffer. You know, this is all nonsense. 99.99% of all teaching on this planet is absolute nonsense, okay? Total nonsense. It's just words put in the mouth of idols that we're too afraid to own ourselves, because if we did, we'd realize how stupid it was. The idea that we're supposed to suffer, that we're supposed to learn the lessons here, go through all this Sturm und Drang and stress and turmoil is nonsense, absolute nonsense. All we need, supposed to do is accept the bliss of God's perfect non-judgment, perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs, which is this perfect judgment. Non-judgment is already present. It's always been present, concurrent with all what-ifs. So all the Holy Spirit is trying to do is to get us to accept this bliss. That's it. Nothing more. Nothing more than that. And its whole thing is right use of time. So whatever Holy Spirit can do that we're accepting of to help us accept the bliss of God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs, that's what it's doing. That is what it's doing for us. So if sidestepping, going to another place, is going to help us, that's what it'll do. It doesn't have any agenda like we're supposed to evolve, or we're supposed to stay in one place, or plant, what do they call it, bloom where you're planted, or all this nonsense about how you're supposed to grind it out, no matter what happens, be loyal, stay in line, all this kind of nonsense. It's total nonsense from idols. No, sidestep. There's some situation that's inimical to your accepting God's perfect, internal non-judgment of all what-ifs, which results in this steady, beautiful, steady state called bliss. If there's something that's truly blocking it, sidestep it. Sidestep it. Save time. The Holy Spirit's all about saving time. That's it. That's all the Holy Spirit's about, is saving time. Saving you time. So it's a perfect teacher. It never loses sight of that all-important mission to save us time. And if there's a situation that is going to delay us, Holy Spirit's right there saying, no way. I have an option for you. I have an option for you. Skip the holes, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Just skip them. Now, you may think, well, I don't ever get to play those holes. What's wrong? No, because I played then 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. And what did I do? Then I went back to the front nine again and played one. I skipped two because I already played it. And I played a three again. I played four quickly. Then I played five. Then I played six, seven, eight, and nine. So the only hole I didn't actually play was 10. And I got in on time. The guy said, the cart's in at 7:15. I had him there. It was 7:10. Perfect. Perfect, perfect. See? So I did get to play it. I just came around. And the cart guy, when I was teeing off on one again, he said, hey, you playing one again, or what's going on? And I explained to him, hey, I had to skip five holes, so I'm just going to go replay those. He goes, okay. Just be have your cart in by 7:15. See? No problem. So just because we skip the situation, you know, doesn't mean that somehow we're going to be deprived of anything. If we really want to, we can meet the situation up ahead, kind of thing. Touch base again. We don't have to. It's not like eternal banishment from the planet or something. Of course, if we leave, those who are in control of the planet will say, well, you can never come back. Well, who's to say that they're going to be able to enforce such a thing, you know? And when you find your game, they can't enforce anything like that on you. They absolutely cannot. Like all bullies, they're just bluffing. They just got you intimidated. They tell you, what do bullies tell you? Bullies always tell you that you can't get out of their control. That's the number one thing that bullies tell you. Because as soon as you find out that you can escape their control, they can't control you, then the mystique of the bully is broken. So we're told constantly here in this world that we're stuck here in this world. There's no, we can nowhere else to go. That's a lie. That's a total lie. It's a lie of bullies. Bullies say all sorts of lies in this world. It's full of lies of bullies. Just to intimidate us and make us feel like we're trapped. And then we have to put up with their bullying. It's like you're in a classroom. In comes a class bully. You know, it's intimidating and pushing and beating up people, and just, you know, everyone's terrified. And then somebody smart enough just looks and says, here comes the bully. Say, wait a minute. Then there's an open window, and they just climb right out the window, gone, out of the classroom. See you later. And then maybe the teachers are scared of the bully too, and teachers say, you can't leave the classroom like that. It's just not allowed. It's not allowed. And I say, goodbye. I'm out the window and gone. You know, you don't wait for the bully. You don't ask permission from the bully. And you don't ask permission from the classroom teacher who's under the influence of the bully either. You just say, hey, here's a window, and I'm out the window. And meanwhile, the other kids in the classroom are continually getting freaked out and intimidated and terrorized by the bully, because the teacher won't give them permission to leave the classroom, because the teacher themselves is scared of the bully, you see? So you cannot be scared of this world by the invaders of this planet. Plus, you cannot be scared of those locals here who have become collaborators with them. and expect ask them for permission. Forget it. They're collaborators. Like the Nazis went into France, and the Vichy French, a lot of French collaborated because the Nazis took over France, and they said, "Hey, you know, you help us out, help us break the French resistance, and things will go good for you." So a lot of French did that. It's called the Vichy French, and those are collaborators. It happens all the time in war, where your country's taken over, a lot of people end up collaborating with the invaders. And same thing here is going on, is a lot of people, locals of this planet, have now become sycophant collaborators with the invaders. And we're used to asking permission from these authority figures of this planet. But the fact right now is they're collaborators, so I'm not going to ask permission of them to leave the planet. Forget it. We don't need any permission. The Holy Spirit's permission is good enough for me, it's good enough for you, it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. So, that is a fact. That's a fact. Let's remember that we have a friend in Jesus, and as well as other great sages, saints, and avatars, and saviors, etc., who give us permission to follow what the Holy Spirit offers us. So when the Holy Spirit offers us something, we have the, Jesus said very specifically, do what the Holy Spirit tells you to do. Accept what it has to offer you. It's your comforter. It's your help. And he says, I give you full authority to do that. Okay? So that's more authority than any authority on this planet. Okay, way more authority, which is something very important with Jesus, is to realize he's a greater authority than any authority on this planet, by far and away. He's the authority of reality. He speaks for reality to us, okay, and reminds us that we too have the authority of reality, and we don't have to listen to idols. Idols don't have any authority over us. So, and the Holy Spirit too is authority of reality. It speaks, has the authority of reality, and it tells us, look, you can escape from idols. Escape from idols. Realize that you're not bound by idols or their authority, because they're really nothing, nothing at all. The thing is that we want to impress the invaders. Show them how great we are. That's the big mistake, and I'm just as guilty of that as anybody. So the important thing is play the fool. Like that guy came up to me on the, that wonderful man on the 11th tee, and then he's like, hey, you know, you look like you don't know what you're doing. Poor guy. Boy. Maybe you should really should think about taking a golf lesson, you know, man. And I just grinned and grinned and grinned like a good boy, and let him have his beliefs. Okay, I'm not gonna waste time explaining anything to him. And then I crushed that drive, just absolutely piped it over 300 yards. See, so if he would have seen that, I'm sure he would have like, gone, what in the heck is going on here? But we don't have to impress anybody on this planet at this point. It's a waste of time. Waste of time. So, I know I've got game, so I don't have to explain that to anybody. Why should I try to? If someone believes I don't, that's okay. That doesn't affect me at all. So, a lot of us don't want to leave this planet because we're too busy wrapped up in trying to impress the invaders, saying, hey, look, invaders, look how talented we are. Look how wise we are. Look kind of game we got. We got game, too. And, of course, the invaders are looking at us like, you guys, really, you need to take a lesson, you know. Have you thought of taking a lesson? Meaning, have you thought of being re-educated? We'll re-educate you. Yes, we will. That's what they're saying, that they'll re-educate us. And we just got to smile and say, no, I haven't thought of being re-educated. You know, but have a nice day. And of course, once we clear out of this situation, we'll find our game. And when we meet again, they'll have a whole different impression, won't they? A whole different impression indeed. And they'll find out we're playing like pros. We'll be pros at that time. Spiritual pros, you know, shooting under par. knowing truth, abiding in bliss, and then they'll pay attention. At this point in time, they're not able to pay attention. There's a fact. This planet right now is unavailable for enlightenment. It is simply temporarily in a twilight zone, as it were, where it's simply the transition is so extreme and stuff going on right now that nobody's really available to really listen and understand and ask the right questions and have the right focus. It's just not. I'm not finding it. Other than rare exceptions, of course. There's always exceptions. But as far as a generalized situation, no way in the world. It's just temporarily inaccessible to right focus. So don't even bother trying to pretend, you know. Don't even bother trying to pretend to the world at large. We have to be humble enough. And as we leave, they'll think, well, we're leaving because we're such losers, we can't handle it here. You know, we're so inept that we just can't handle their advanced planet. So we're like troglodytes, you know, or we're being kicked back to a lower level because we're not able to evolve in the way that they're able to evolve. That's what they're thinking. Just like the man was thinking, like, wow, this guy, obviously poor guy, this course is going to beat the living daylights out of him. And he just doesn't know what he's doing out here. He's really in for it. And as he left, he said, boy, golf can be a really tough game. He's kind of letting me know that, hey, he knows what's going to happen to me. Well, that's not what happened. Not what's happened at all. It crushed the course. And that was very, very interesting. So as they tell us, oh, you're leaving, you're sidestepping, oh, it must be because you're incompetent. And you just have to smile and say, well, yeah, just pretend to agree, or at least don't disagree. You don't really have to agree, you just don't make a big deal of disagreeing. Just kind of smile, yeah, okay. See you later. Adios. Vaya con Dios, auf Wiedersehen. And then, later on, they'll find out. It's like, huh, you got game. Wow, amazing. Man, you won't hold it over him. You won't lord it over him or anything, but you know, you'll help him out at that time. But right now, no, you can't make the right impressions in this world. You cannot make the right impressions. That's what I'm trying to say. You cannot make the right impressions on this planet right now. It's impossible. It's just not going to happen. Jesus himself could come to this planet. He wouldn't make the right impressions here either. Could not. People are so upside down and backwards and in turmoil. The locals here are in turmoil because they are being battered and bullied from every possible angle, and they are literally depressed. Depressed. I mean, depression is severe on this planet right now. Because that's what happens, like when you, when a like a country is taken over by another invading force, and subjugated, and all the laws change, and the people get very depressed, very, very depressed. They get sick. They get all sorts of diseases and sicknesses, and you know, look what happened to the American Indians. They just despondent. I mean, what happened to our civilization? What happened to our culture? It's destroyed. How did it get destroyed? Why did it get destroyed? All, you know, there are these questions, and they get so depressed. It's horrible. So the locals, natives of this planet, are getting very depressed right now. And the invaders, of course, you can't make any impression upon them. And when the locals are super depressed, you cannot make an impression on them either. They just kind of have to say, they say, like, what's the difference? What does it matter? You know, who cares? I mean, it's not going to help, and so why even pester me with that? Like I said, Jesus could come back, and people would just say, well, so what? Big deal. You know, it's our lives are in tatters, and this whole situation is just horrible. We've got no future here, and we're being forced into positions that we don't like, and it's just awful what's happening on this planet. Truly atrocious. And of course, the invaders think it's absolutely great. They think it's like, hey, this is wonderful for you guys. This is great. And it's like the East India Company saying, hey, you guys, guess what? You get to grow opium and jute and we'll export the jute and the opium and make tons of money, and we'll build great big houses, and you can, if you're lucky, you'll be able to wash our feet. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't progress great? And see, they think, hey, everybody should be happy. We're happy. Why isn't everybody else happy? We're making tons of money. How come everybody else isn't happy? And they try to make an impression upon those people and forget it. They just look at you like you're insane. So, it's not the time to make any impression in this world. So that's why I waited until that golfer was gone before I, hit the drive. And then later on, I was playing behind him, but I tried to stay far enough behind him so he couldn't see what I was doing, because I was just crushing the ball, just hitting great shots, drawing a ball around a corner with a 5 iron, right, long and right in the middle, and just hitting it, right on the pin, uphill, and just crushing it. But I kept waiting until he was cleared out ahead of me so he didn't see what I was doing, because I didn't want to shatter his illusions that I was some complete rank beginner. So he'd think like he, silly, I don't want to do that. Why should I do that? It's not the time right now to press the issues in this world. It's not the time. Which is why you don't see these mega maha gurus in the world right now. You don't see it. Because it's not the time to press the issue. Absolutely not. You just won't get anywhere. At the best, you'll seem to be completely eccentric, which is not a good situation to feel, like if everybody thinks you're totally eccentric. So it's better to play the fool. It's better to play the fool. That's what in Carlos Castaneda's books, Don Juan, The Yaqui Way of Knowledge, and all those books, Don Juan always said the highest way, the best way in the world now is to play the fool. Got to play the fool. Don't try to make an impression upon the world. Absolutely not. It's the wrong time, the wrong place for that. Man, good advice. Very good advice. Be humble, be simple, and don't try to pretend to, don't try to, look the part of some great guru who's going to make impressions upon the world at this point. Just like, don't go out and look like on a golf course, look like Joe Golfer, Joe or Jane Golfer. You see these golfers, and they've got all the latest clothes, all the latest fashions, all the latest clubs, all the latest accessories and accoutrements and the balls. Everything they've got is just says brand spanky new and the best, and they're out there, and they're just like, they're saying, basically say, I'm gonna crush this course. Watch me, watch me. I'm one heck of a golfer. And then, of course, if you play golf with them, you find out they scuffle like crazy. But it's always just an off day for them. Just an off day, off shot. That's shame. But we got this course. We got it. We're gonna crush it. Puts it's like that. Don't be like that. Don't be like that now. Lay low, lay low, lay low. So, it's not a good time to go full blast and trying to make an impression upon the world that you're wise, that you know the truth. Because what the world wants is to the culture of the planet to be changed to fit these people from the other planets that have invaded this planet. And that's what they want. And they want everything to be streamlined that way. And they want to get rid of any notion of freedom, any notion you could escape from this planet, escape from their authority, escape from their control, because they're control freaks, because they get a sense of identity through controlling others, through restricting others. That's how they get a sense of identity. So if they feel that they can't restrict or control you, they feel they're losing their identity. And so, of course, they're going to cast a very dim eye towards anything as it smacks of freedom at all. They're the ones who grant the freedom. So they want to be bestowers of freedom upon you. You announce your subservience to them, and then they will regally grant you some sort of charter, for some freedom. It's like the East India Company. If you fought in their battles and helped defeat their enemies, then they would and showed your subservience to them and accepted their taxes and their legal structure and all that stuff, then they would say, "Oh, well, you are now, we'll call you the Maharaj of this place, and you will rule under our benevolent charter." And then you get some pull, you see, in the world if you do it that way. In other words, you're a collaborator. So if you become a really helpful collaborator, then you get the choice businesses and you get some money and you get some influence. Like the Nawabs of Dhaka, the Nawabs collaborated with the East India Company and the Indian government and were granted tons of money and power and land and all this stuff, and they, you know, had a lot of authority because they collaborated that way. That's how it works. So if you help crush freedom, you will end up having crumbs of at least superficial freedom in this world as a collaborator. But who wants that? Who wants that? So as much as it may irk you or irk any one of us, it's better to play the fool at this time and not come on too strong. You don't have to be overboard. I mean, I wasn't trying to look like I was completely incompetent on the golf course. I just didn't want anyone to draw the opposite conclusion that I was somehow very competent, which I'm really not. But I just didn't want to lean in that direction at all. It's better to lean in the direction of benefit of the doubt that, hey, he's really nothing here, nothing of interest here, nothing here. Move on. So you can still play your game. I can still do these videos and etc. It's okay. It's a very small scale, under the radar, adventure here. But I'm not out there. In the big time, and by any means, nobody's asking me for any interviews or anything, and so I'm laying very low, very, very, very low, because I know it's not the time to try to make an impression upon anyone in this world, really. But when the time comes, sidestepping, you find our game. When the time comes, then absolutely can make the right impression. Right time, right place for that. There's a time and a place for making great impressions. Now is not the time or place to make great impressions. So that's why the Holy Spirit keeps emphasizing sidestep the troubles that are coming up. It's a temporary thing. It's not like we're banished from the planet forever. I didn't leave the golf course. I was thinking of leaving, actually. I was very ready to leave, and I decided, no, let me go to the 11th hole. So it's not like we're kicked out of existence or anything like that. It's just saying, hey, let's go somewhere else for a while, hang out, find our power, find our bliss, and then we'll touch base again with situations that we want to. No problem. So that seems to be what the Holy Spirit's indicating, that it now is not the time for great impressions. And accepting that is not easy, I'll tell you that. It's not easy. Because for me, it seems like I could make a great impression, but it's not the time. It's not the time. You just make a great fool of yourself, is what will happen. Because there's too many obstacles and roadblocks that will be thrown in your way. and people will just start shooting you a bunch of ideological BS about what's your position on this, what's your position on this. And being just an honest, straight shooter that I am, I would tell it like it is. But the world is not interested in hearing it like it is. Absolutely not interested. They really, really, really don't want to get into that, because either A, they want to change everything, or B, they're super depressed and they don't have the stomach for it. They don't have the will. They don't have the will. The people of the world don't have the will right now to stand up and say no to the invaders. They don't have the will. They've been defeated on so many fronts. They've been pushed around in so many ways. They're demoralized. Really demoralized. And it's kind of like a straitjacket. The more you struggle, the more bound you feel. That's really the kind of situation that's been set up, is the more you fight against it, the more entrapped you get in it. And so people are despondent. There's so many people who have struggled against it and ended up just being absolutely tied down and just horrible. And so people are saying, wow, this is scary. This is scary. I mean, the more you struggle, the worse it gets for you. So for me, sidestep it. Sidestep it. Listen to those helpers of this world, and Jesus is one of them for sure, and saying, hey, don't worry, you'll be able to sidestep the situation. And so let's not give up on that. Let's not give up just because there's no tangible evidence. The Holy Spirit's obviously preparing us for that. Because this is the future on this planet, forget it. Absolutely forget it. Of course the invaders think it's going to be wonderful because it's going to be conformed to their expectations. But their expectations are not my expectations at all. I find their expectations to be very, very unpalatable and distasteful. Extreme ignorance, extreme lack of freedom. A tremendous fear of God. The way that they structure society symbolizes and structures the design, encapsulates an enormous fear of God, an enormous ignorance and fear of God, which for me, I don't have that. So to me, it's like living in hell, absolute hell. Where instead of you teaching kindergarten students, the kindergarten students are teaching you, you know, their kindergarten foolishness. Well, that's no place at all to be. I mean, the world is foolish and whimsical and fearful of God already severely, but at least people on this planet, the natives, at least have some inkling of listening and paying attention and respect for this, whereas the invaders don't. Don't. And now the collaborators now are going overboard to prove their loyalty by spitting on anything that has to do with truth and salvation, and demonizing it and marginalizing it and making it seem it's the province of feeble minds. That any of this stuff that we're talking about is a sure indicator of extreme feeble minds. And you get the overwhelming amount of people on the planet fervently believing that, and it really becomes too much to bear. It really does. You start to doubt yourself. No matter how clear your mind is, you start to doubt yourself. Because if everyone tells you that everything you're saying and that you believe is a certain indication of extremely feeble mind and extreme incompetence. And they're all positive about it, and they act as if that is true, and they marginalize you because they feel that you're retarded, and you really cannot partake of their ways and their life and anything because you're incapable of it, and they see that as a shame, and finally they just stop even they ignore you like you're not even there. They stop even paying any attention, as if you didn't exist. Well, that eventually wears you down. It eventually wears just about anybody down, except for like the those who are enlightened. They could handle that, but you have to be perfectly enlightened to handle that. And since we're not perfectly enlightened, it wears us down. So I have no interest in getting worn down. Nobody should. Nobody should have to put up with this nonsense. It's like the barbarians have, you know, sacked Rome. They've taken over the Roman Empire. The sophisticated savages are now in charge. It's really what's happened. I mean, modern-day Rome has been sacked. The Western world civilization has been sacked by barbarians. It's what happened to Rome, right? Visigoths and the Goths and the Vandals came pouring in from pagan Europe and just laid waste to Rome. And so that's happened in this planet over and over. Now it's happening again. Is the wisdom culture of this planet is being laid waste to and marginalized and thrown in the gutter and ground up for mulch. And any wisdom that you do bring out of great impressions, it's expropriated. It's co-opted, like by Oprah. You know, you come on the show and you're a spiritual teacher like Eckhart Tolle, and the eventual gist of it is she forms a like an cooperative venture with him or with Course in Miracles or whatever. And the gist of it really is that it's now Oprah who's telling you. She says, "Oh, I get it. I understand it here. I'll explain it to everybody. We don't need Eckhart Tolle. We don't need A Course in Miracles. We got Oprah who's going to explain it to us." You see? And you get all these sycophants who believe this. Say, "Oh yeah, she knows. She knows. She can tell us. She'll tell us the truth. What comes from out of her mouth is a high truth, high wisdom." So you have these social engineers steering public, see, in that direction, away from the original source, and putting a middle person in there that supposedly knows it better than the source or those who actually do know it really truly, you see. So it gets all watered down and distorted, and people think that it. You know, they don't even bother looking at the actual Course in Miracles and actually studying it for themselves. They don't look within to see what's there. They just say, "Oh, Oprah tells it. We'll tell them whatever she says. We'll believe." That kind of stuff. That kind of stuff is just, you know, that's what's happening. That's what's happening. You have all these celebrities, all these people who we think. We'll follow what they're our leaders, and that they somehow know the truth. So whatever you try to raise in this world to make a great impression, if you want it to be popularized and make a big impression, great impression, you have to go through these gatekeepers, these social engineering gatekeepers. Otherwise, you'll get nowhere. You get nowhere. Because the whole information industry now is all controlled from top to bottom, and it's infiltrated. And if you don't play ball with them, they'll crush you. If you don't let them seem like they're the ones who are wise, and that they have the real message, and that you are actually have a lesser message than they do, then you're not going to get anywhere. It's amazing. And they say, "Oh yeah, okay, this teacher says this and this and this, and this is what they mean." And what they mean is, "We're going to build a beautiful, perfect utopia here in this world, and we got to make all these changes and stuff, blah 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 blah." Which really means that they have to shape and form and change this world into the kind of culture that they're used to, that the invaders are used to, those who are taking over this planet are used to. That's what they're really saying. And they need to crush and get rid of all the old stuff that the locals, local customs, those are no good, you know. Those guys are feeble-minded, customs of the feeble-minded and superstitious. They think there's some kind of freedom, you know. How superstitious. They think they can get to heaven. How presumptuous and arrogant of them. We'd haven't given them permission. They'd have to buy, and they'd have to wait for us. We'd have to go first anyway. They're way, way down, you know. They'll be the last ones to get in. So how utterly presumptuous of them to think such things. And such presumption is obviously the product of feeble minds. It's funny, isn't it? You gotta laugh. It's upside down. You got like third graders telling, you know, the teachers what to do. You got the inmates running the asylum. You got people with profound ignorance telling people what is true. You got those who are absolutely terrified of God saying that they love God and they know exactly what God wants you to do. Yeah, right? God wants, what they tell you is that you gotta hide from God. You gotta bury yourself from God so God can never find you. That's what they're really saying. See, who wants to go in that direction, hiding from God, burying yourself under deepest you can possibly bury yourself in the greatest darkness possible? Who wants to do that? I sure don't. I'm not afraid of God. I've been in the presence of God. I know God is absolutely wonderful. Doesn't have the slightest bit of anger towards us or fear or anything. Just the greatest of affection and love and good humor towards us. And just complete acceptance. No judgment whatsoever. Radiantly pleased with us, you know. The most loving and kindest regards possible. Perfect, pure purity. And that's what God is. And so there's no reason to fear God in the slightest bit. So these people are trying to institutionalize the terror of God, feeling utterly terrified of God. And of course, they twist it by saying that, oh no, we know God, and this is what God wants you to do. Wants you to hide. Wants you to hide, play hide and seek. No, God does not want us to play hide and seek. We're free to do it, but God doesn't judge our hide and seek at all. Pays no attention to it. So we don't want to be pushed down into greater and greater hiding from God, because that's really a nasty situation. Gets very confusing. It's not understandable. Insanity is not understandable, because unstable is whimsical. Whimsy is not understandable. There's nothing there that's understandable. So what ifs, all what ifs are pure whimsy. So what ifs are not understandable. Only God's non-judgment upon what ifs is understandable within what ifs, which is bliss. Bliss is understandable. So we want to go towards bliss. We don't want to go towards digging a great big old hole and then jumping in that hole. I had a dream last night. There was this massive sinkhole in my front yard. You know, it's like, whoa, looked at that. Where did that come from? Overnight, there's this huge sinkhole. So I don't want that. That's terrible. That was just showing me that there's this great pit being dug in the world right now. Pit of ignorance, pit of darkness, pit of confusion. And if we don't get the heck out of here, we're going to be flung down into that pit. Which for me is completely untenable. It's, I've left the darkness, I've left the ignorance behind, so I can't go back to ignorance. That's not possible. Absolutely not possible. That would require total split mind, total dissociation, split mind to do that. And I've already worked to overcome that, you know, so to come here in this world requires a split mind. But now they're asking you to disassociate to an extraordinary extent from what you know is true. So you literally have to just split your mind. Your mind has to be like in a split condition, and it's just horrible. Absolutely horrible. So we can't do that. But relocation is, again, something that we need to keep an open mind and keep on saying, hey, you know, this could happen, and just keep asking the Holy Spirit for help. Jesus said, don't worry about the ways and the means. When the time comes, you'll know the ways and the means. So we don't know for sure what the ways and the means are at this point. We have some inkling of it, of course. Someone said that these orbs are could be like bliss bodies, or there's a connection to us. Our light bodies, or our light bodies, or something, and that the light bodies can transport us to some other place. That's possible. There could be lots of different ways of transport. There could be a shifting, an ascension. It'll probably be pretty easy. So, don't. What I'm saying here is, one, don't worry about trying to make a huge, great impression upon the world at this point in time. It's not possible. Two, it's okay to play the fool. It's okay to lay low. You don't have to try to impress anybody in this world at this point. That's very important. Three, keep an open mind towards relocation. Four, realize that the relocation is likely to result in you finding your power, finding your game, finding your bliss, and really finally realizing, wow, I'm not a victim of the world that I see. I'm not a victim of the world that I see. You will realize that. And then at some point down the road, you will make a great impression for sure. It's just a delayed great impression. Right now is not the time for great impressions, and the world simply is not ready for that. It's not. So just keep that, this paradigm in mind. Keep this paradigm in mind. Now, of course, you see the world, all sorts of people making fake great impressions. They're, you know, popular and famous and doing all this stuff. And it's like very galling to see them. Like you see them and say, man, I could do way better than that. I mean, this is just amateur hour. And it's upsetting to see that. I say, wow. Well, because that's all by design. It's all by design. So if you try to step in there and do better, there's all sorts of defenses there to just make you look like a fool. Just make you look like a fool. So again, that's the price you have to pay. You have to let the dog. Every dog has its day. Let the dog of ignorance have its day. That's okay. That's all right. Let them play golf the way they want to. Let them be foolish for a while longer. Let them be whimsical for a while longer. Oh, no problem. That will not affect your ability to make a great impression at some point. So this is the message that I've been trying to bring through, and it's being reinforced here. Be humble, be wise. There's nothing. That's not saying you can't say stuff, which I am saying, but it's on a very low key situation, actually. Very low key. And I'm not entangled with, you know, with the world. I'm just one channel, you know, one conduit here of just putting out videos on YouTube, and for whoever wants to see them. But that's it. That's it. I'm not dealing with publishers. Not dealing with publicists. Not dealing with nonprofits and NGOs. Not making money for anybody, and not holding seminars, retreats, not going on radio or television or blogs or whatever, you know, just very low key. And that's the Holy Spirit. It's by design. And no matter what I do, I can't change that. I'm not being able to change anything like that. So it's basically saying, hey, now's not the time to make a great impression. But we can prepare to head for freedom, sidestep the loss of freedom, which is astronomical right now on this planet. The loss of freedom is virtually incalculable at this point. And that's not good for anyone. It's not good for anyone. It's not good for us for sure. So those who realize it's not good for them, be open and be willing. So I'm hoping that there'll be more information as we go along about sidestepping the situation. All right, this is frozen up right now, so it's as good as any time to stop. I think it just stopped almost automatically there. Okay. What happened? I don't know. The picture just vanished. Well, picture's vanished. Audio still recording. Oh, there. Okay, we're back. Hey, there you go. There's a perfect example of sidestepping the situation. Picture's gone. I mean, there's no picture up there. First it froze up, then phew, no picture at all. And now it's back. See? Fantastic. All right, on that note, we will end this one. And blessings to everybody. Be of good spirit. Be of good cheer. Keep warding off depression. I know it's a very depressing time in the world. As we realize that the time for us to make a great impression is not now. That's depressing. That is depressing. At some point, we'll be able to accept it and say, okay, all right. Alrighty, very great. That's it for this video.